welcome back to my channel. My name is Trisha, and in today's video, we are going to basically be reflecting on my entire past of reptile keeping and look at my standards and how they have changed. Because I was looking at like a couple of my old videos and just like old photos, and it was just so crazy how much my standards for reptile keeping have changed, and basically how everyone's have changed like over the years of doing this. And I don't know, I wanted to talk about it because I think that it's an important thing to reflect on how far we have come and just to kind of see like the changes to come in the future as well regarding reptile keeping. So I thought that this would be kind of a fun video just to go over my thoughts and my own reflection on my own animals that I have been keeping and the changes that I've made. So I wrote out a little list and we're gonna run through it. So the first thing that I noticed were the size requirements. And I've noticed this a lot because I've done a lot of care videos in the past. And in those care videos, like honestly, I feel like it's almost like nearly all of them, my idea of the size requirement has changed and definitely increased from whatever I was saying in those videos. So I feel like that's an important thing to talk about because I know people are still watching those videos. I'm not sure if I should like run through all of my care videos and do like a new updated version on them or how I should do this. But yeah, there's definitely like in the past, I would say that crested geckos and gargoyle geckos were fine in a 12 by 12 by 18. And that is just like so inadequate from like how I feel right now and how I've been keeping my animals. Like I just think that that is like way too small. I don't want people thinking that that's what I still think is okay. It's just because time has gone by and my standards have changed, and I feel like most people have changed their standards about that as well. Like now the minimum for those animals is an 18 by 18 by 24 or a 30 gallon or a 2 by 2 by 2. So like all of those are adequate, but like a 12 by 12 by 18 is like literally like a little shoebox for those geckos and they can't do anything. And it's just, it seems like it's kind of like a form of abuse to keep them in that while they're adults, honestly. So it's just way too small. And then like another one that I did was leopard geckos. I would say that they're okay in a 20 gallon. And like I did this one video in the past where I put them in like this little, it was like a storage container. I think I deleted the video because I just absolutely hated it. One gecko escaped from it. It was not enough space. I just hated the whole thing. I thought it would be a good idea and like it would be an idea to like save space. Oh God, it was like one of the worst things I've ever done. Honestly, for like a leopard gecko, I would recommend the smallest to be a 40 gallon, and like the more floor space you can give them, the better. So like a 20 gallon just absolutely does not cut it for a leopard gecko at all. So all of my standards have just completely changed. It's just, ugh. Looking back at like some of the like requirements of like me, what I used to say is just like so painful because I'm like, oh, I would not recommend that anymore. And like my videos are just getting older and like, but people are still gonna be watching them. So I just wanted to make an update and talk about my standards because of this, because it kind of drives me crazy. I'm not even sure what I said a ball python would be. I think I said it would be a 40 gallon and I don't agree with that either. I think they need a minimum of a 4 foot enclosure, which would be a 75 gallon. And honestly, even bigger than that, I think would be better. I think that like, honestly, with any reptile, the bigger, the better. So that was a huge thing that I wanted to cover. And that's why it was so long. And if you guys want to like ask me other questions, like what requirements for specific animals, I'll leave it for you in the comments, because I feel like I could turn that into an entire video talking about my standards for reptile enclosure sizes. So yeah, we're going to move on to the next one so I can fit all of these in the video. So the next one that I put is a bare minimum mentality. So obviously this already sounds like a negative thing, but like when I first started keeping reptiles, I had this bare minimum mentality because it was what I was surrounded with. Like whenever you would go to a Petco or anything, they'd be like, oh yeah, you can just keep this animal in this for its entire life, it'll be fine. And so you would think that that is like the biggest you would have to go was the minimum, which is just completely wrong and like not what you should be doing. And that is like the mentality that I had because that was the one that I had seen everyone else have when it came to keeping reptiles. Like, oh, you only need this for this animal, so get this one. And then you do that and it's like, bare minimum, it's really not good enough, but you think it's okay because someone told you it's okay. And it's just like, you should never think like that. Honestly, when you get an animal, you should think about how big they're going to get and how much size you would want to give them potentially for the rest of their life. Because I feel like just going larger is the best thing you could possibly do. So changing the way that you think about it and perceive things is very important. The third thing I put is naturalistic backgrounds. So this is something that I have really gotten into in the past like couple of years. And now, like, it's so painful for me to have an animal that doesn't have a naturalistic background. It's definitely not a requirement, but for me, like, aesthetically, like, I need it. And I think that it brings so much enrichment to the animals as well. So, especially when they're climbing on it and using it, and it just looks so nice. Like, whenever I see someone that just has, like, a glass tank and it just has, like, an empty background, kind of kills my soul a little bit. Like, I just want to decorate it and like utilize that background and turn it into something that the animal can use as well. Even if it can't really climb, it just looks so much better. So I just, naturalistic backgrounds are just like my aesthetic right now, and I just am obsessed with them and having so much fun making them. So that's definitely not something that I did in the past. In the past, I thought that, I remember seeing one for the first time and thinking, wow, I'm never going to be able to do something like that. And now that I've actually conquered my fear and tried it out and learned how to do it, it is so much fun. And it's such a great way to get creative as well. So, and I love like crafty things. So when I can apply crafts and reptiles, it is a win-win situation. The fourth thing is the number of animals. So when I was getting into keeping more reptiles, it was kind of around the time that like YouTubers became like a thing, and like everyone just like was all about the quantity, and they just wanted to just like show this big flashy number. And I feel like that is like a thing that everyone looks at now and they're just like, oh my God, why did I do that? And it's like embarrassing, because that's just absolutely not the right way to keep animals. It's a horrible mentality to have. It should always be quality over quantity. It really doesn't matter how many animals you have. It matters how much you're going to be giving those animals and how much space you can give them, how much enrichment. All of that is just so much more superior than having a big number of reptiles that you have, because you don't want it to be like a gross hoarding situation where those animals are getting bare minimum care just because you have so many of them. So that is definitely something that I've seen change over the years. I did have a lot of geckos in the past, and because my standards changed and I wanted larger upgrades that I knew I couldn't provide, that's why I did a lot of downsizing as well as having health issues. So it's something that I definitely wanted to cover in this video, because it was a wake-up call. It was a huge wake-up call, because I was breeding and then I decided not to, and then I just had all of these geckos and it was overwhelming, and I thought they were in way too small enclosures. So it's just one of those learning lessons that I've had over the years that I think is really important. Which brings me to number five, which is breeding. So I kind of had in my mind when I first started keeping geckos that I wanted to breed them, and once I finally moved to this apartment was when I was able to start breeding them. And it wasn't quite what I thought it would be. It was a lot of fun at first, but then it just turned into kind of a stressful situation to find them homes, because I didn't want to ship them anymore, because I had one animal that I shipped that passed away, and it was just like traumatizing, and I feel so bad about it, and I just will always feel bad about that situation. So, I mean, when it comes to breeding, after that, I was like, I'm done with everything. I had plans of like breeding African fat tail geckos, really wanted to breed Bowie, my Brazilian rainbow boa. And then I just gave up all of that. I really don't have the space to do something like that. I might consider breeding gargoyle geckos potentially in the future. But I really don't think I have any other plans of breeding anything, and I don't even know if that's going to happen for sure. But yeah, that's pretty much where I've grown and changed when it comes to breeding. It really just, for me, it's all about quality rather than quantity. And when you're breeding, you're obviously going to get a lot of geckos or whatever you're breeding. So it's something to keep in mind. Number six is wild caught versus captive bred. So in the past, I don't know. I feel like maybe I've thought the same thing this entire time. I always thought that captive bred was just a healthier, better option, a more ethical option, unless you are a breeder trying to bring in new bloodlines. And I don't think that my thoughts have changed on that. I do still agree with that. And I mean, when I got Chancho, my wild caught Indonesian blue tongue skink, I was not aware that he was wild caught. It's not something that I want to promote. It's not something that I would have done had I known that he was actually wild caught. But that was pretty much my only situation with that. But yeah, my ideas are still the same. Like, I don't really want to get any wild caught animals unless I plan to breed them for conservation. But right now, I have zero plans for that. So if you're looking for a pet, I always recommend to get captive bred, and I will stand by that. I've stood by that since the beginning. Number seven is UVB for reptiles. So this was kind of like another bare minimum type of idea. And a lot of my videos, I'd be like, oh yeah, it's so great because this animal doesn't need UVB, so you can just do bare minimum. And UVB has been studied so much for reptiles lately, and it benefits them, all of them. Like, even if it's not a requirement, it is something that can be beneficial and it should be tried. There can be some obstacles with this because UVB can be extremely expensive, especially if you have a lot of reptiles or you just don't have the space or the bulbs for like all of them when you have a lot of animals. That's like the issue that I'm having with mine. But ideally, I would love to have all of my animals on UVB. I think that it is something that you need to be careful with, though. Make sure that you're getting the right kind and make sure that you're measuring it with a solar meter if you can, because you do want to make sure that your animals are getting the proper amount of D3 synthesis. So it's just one of those tricky situations I've talked about in other videos, but I think that it is beneficial to give your animals UVB if you can. In the past, I would just be like, you don't need it, just don't worry about it. Now it's like, no, it is something that you should consider. Number eight is enrichment and bioactive and plants and all the good stuff. I feel like in the past, just looking back at some of my enclosures, I was like, oh my God, I can't believe I kept my animal like that. Like, keeping my leopard gecko in like this really narrow tank on paper towels with like two hides and then like a little piece of cork bark to climb on. It was like the lamest setup of all time. And I just, compared to what I have now for Kiwi with a naturalistic background, with sticks built into it, things to climb on, he utilizes every single aspect of that enclosure. And I'm like, shame on old Trisha for keeping Kiwi how I kept Kiwi before, because it was just so sad. And I think that the more naturalistic you can go, the better for the animal. So definitely my old enclosures are just like killing my soul. It was the same thing for Mango before she was bioactive. She was just on paper towels. And I just, like, looking back at those enclosures, I'm like, why did I do that? Why did I think that was okay? Because just like making the switch was such an impeccable difference that like, it's just crazy that I ever had them any other way. So that's definitely a huge change that I've had over the years. And then number nine is obvious. Like, over time, the longer that you're keeping these animals, the more knowledge you're going to learn. Things are changing constantly. There are new standards being set. We must always try to keep up to date and do our research. Research should never stop when you keep a reptile. You shouldn't just try to do all the research that you can before you get an animal and then think that that's enough. Once you have the animal, you should continue to research as much as you can, because there's always going to be new things to learn and new ways to improve the lives of our reptiles in captivity. So that is definitely something, like, if you watch my old videos, there's going to be things that I don't agree with anymore, and there's going to be standards that I still just, that I don't agree with, that I think are in the past, and I have made improvements since them, and I have different beliefs now. So I do feel like it's important to talk about that, especially if people are watching some of my older videos. If you see one of them and you think something, you could just ask me, because obviously my standards have changed. I don't know what I should do with my old videos. This channel has been going much longer than I ever thought it would. I really had no plan when I started my YouTube channel. I was just kind of doing it for like fun, I guess. Like, I wasn't doing anything. I was super sick, and I just wanted to do something with my time and thought it would be helpful to make care videos, and then it turned into like a much bigger thing than I ever anticipated. So now that it's been going for so long, there's been so many changes, and it's so weird when people watch like a really old video and then like they think that I think 18 or 12 by 12 by 18 is okay for a crested gecko, and it's like, no, it's not. Like, so I don't know if I should go through my videos or if I should redo care videos. You guys should let me know what your thoughts are on that. Because I just want to make sure that my information is okay for people that are watching all of my videos, because I have hundreds of them now, which is just crazy. So yeah, please leave a comment. Let me know what standards you guys have changed. What are some things that you've done in the past that you don't agree with anymore? And just things that you want to see change in the future as well when it comes to reptile keeping. I would love to hear it. So thank you guys so much for watching today's video. I hope that you liked it, and I will see you guys in the next one.